Recorded Books presents Rune Seeker by J.M. Clarke and C.J. Thompson. Narrated by Ralph Lister. Chapter 1. Everfail. Hiral took a deep breath as he stared at the stylized sun on the heavy door in front of him. The same sun, tattooed on the center of his chest. Both the symbol and source of a shaper's power. His power, if he managed to pass the test. No, he couldn't think like that. He would pass this time. He had to. You're nervous. The gravelly voice of his teacher and sponsor, Lone, came from behind him. You always roll your right foot and stand on the edge of it when you're thinking too much. Hiral snapped the sole of his foot back down on the ground, the thin wooden sandal of his ceremonial outfit clapping on the stone. Nothing wrong with thinking, he said to his mentor without turning. You always tell me to visualize. I'm visualizing. I tell you to visualize success. Shaping. Forging your will and the energy granted to you by the sun to bring your tattoos to life. This, what you're doing now, is visualizing failing. Lone's comforting hand dropped onto Hiral's shoulder. Hiral took another deep breath, letting it flow out of his lungs along with the building anxiety. Lone was right. Hiral was nervous. I know you want to, so go ahead and take a look at your status window. I can practically see your fingers itching, Lone said. Hiral started. Would it make a difference? He knew what it said, what it always said. But then again, if it had changed, finally, then maybe it would ease his nerves. Just give me a second. Hiral reached his hand up to the sun on his chest and pushed gently on it, the warmth of the solar energy flowing through his body, focusing on that spot. Do you want me to share the window? He asked Lone. No need. It will be your turn any minute now. Hiral nodded and pulled on the only magic he could use, his status window, and the information sprang to life in front of his eyes, like he was reading from a luminescent blue page. Name, Hiral Dorin. Race, Maker. Class, unavailable. Attributes, strength, 18-0. Endurance, 18-0. Dexterity, 20-0. Intelligence, 18-0. Wisdom, 18-0. Attunement, 18-0. Solar energy processing. Absorption rate, S rank. Capacity, S rank. Output rate, unavailable. Abilities, tattoos. Herald of Peace, head left, unavailable. Herald of War, head right, unavailable. Perfect Sense, ear left, unavailable. The Crowd has won, ear right, unavailable. Equilibrium, neck, unavailable. Wings of Anella, shoulders, both, unavailable. Spear of Clouds, spine, unavailable. Way of Shadow, chest, left, unavailable. Way of Light, chest, right, unavailable. Banner of Courage, bicep, left, unavailable. Banner of Despair, bicep, right, unavailable. Touch of the Primal, abdomen, left, unavailable. Abode of Asinef, abdomen, right, unavailable. Dagger of Sath, forearm, left, unavailable. Dagger of En, forearm, right, unavailable. The Pack, thigh, left, unavailable. Waters of Frey, thigh, right, unavailable. Path of Butterflies, calf, left, unavailable. Disc of Passage, calf, right, unavailable. Well, the constant training had paid off, with his strength and dexterity both increasing by a point. That was no surprise, really. His eyes continued down the page until he found what he was looking for. Output rate, unavailable. No change to my output rate. Hiral withdrew the power fueling, the status window, and the page vanished. I'm sure it's wrong, though. I mean, I can open my status window, so there has to be some output. But when had a status window ever been wrong? No, don't think like that. It has to be. Remember your training, Lone said, having had this discussion dozens of times in the past. He added a squeeze of Hiral's shoulder. You work harder than anybody else. Practice longer. Your mind is sharper than any of the other initiates, and 90% of the full shapers. Present company excluded, of course. I'm also 10 years senior to any of the other initiates, and older than many full shapers. Present company excluded. Despite his words, he found himself quirking a smile back at his mentor. Meridian lines spanned the towering older man's cheeks and forehead, running back across his shaved head and then down his neck to vanish beneath the loose robes he wore today. Due to years of shaping, the lines had a faint luminescence to them against his dark skin. Those same lines glowed where they showed on his arms and the backs of his hands, their power feeding the intricate and similarly shining tattoos that covered him from head to toe. If Hiral passed the test, mastered his power, that was what he would look like in a few years. Sure, he was leaner than his teacher. The man, like most shapers, was almost as wide as he was tall, with arms as thick as Hiral's legs. And while the tattoos covering Lone's 7-foot-tall body glowed with the energy he absorbed from the sun, Hiral's were noticeably dark. Not for long, though. This time he'd...
You didn't shave your head.
Lone's words interrupted Hiral's thoughts, and the older man glanced at the unruly mop on Hiral's scalp. Hiral started, but a gong sounded from the opposite side of the door, catching the rest of his excuse in his throat and setting his heart thumping like a drum in his chest.
Breathe, Lone said, with another squeeze of Hiral's shoulder. Let's go.
Hiral nodded at his teacher, and the bigger man let go of Hiral's shoulder and stepped in front of him. He then put both hands on the heavy stone doors and leaned into them, legs bracing. Muscles bunched on Lone's back between the wide strips of cloth that crisscrossed his upper half, meridian lines flaring as he called on his sun-granted strength. With the power of the meridian lines and being mid-B rank, Lone had to have close to 160 strength, almost 10 times what Hiral had, or more. A grinding along the stone floor accompanied a gentle grunt escaping the man's lips, and a gap split down the middle of the doors, bright sunlight piercing the darker room. The huge doors, symbolic in the strength required to open them, parted to reveal the open-air testing stadium. A warm, sun-drenched breeze rushed into the opening and over Hiral's skin, his body instinctively reaching for the light and pulling some of that power into his core. While he couldn't output any of that power, yet, drawing it in was just as easy as breathing.
Come, Lone said, taking his hands off the thick blocks of stone, pretending to be doors.
He strode towards the centre of the stadium, where 7 equally massive shapers stood waiting, along with 6 much smaller initiates. Barely more than children, the oldest possibly 10 years old, if that, they were almost comical beside the huge, sun-powered shapers.
Years of pulling on the sun's energy had made the shaper's physiques legendary. Each in the B rank and standing 7 feet tall on average, their corded muscles bunched and flexed with every breath. Like Lone, their meridian lines glowed faintly from long use, though their individual tattoos varied widely, giving each of them unique strengths.
"You've got to be kidding,"
one of the women said when her eyes fell on Hiral stepping into the stadium.
"This is a waste of our time."
She focused her ire on Lone and crossed her arms.
"Tuckhill is right. We're done,"
the man beside her said, turning his attention to the 6 initiates. Each of the children stood tall and proud where they lined up, none with more than the sun on their chests and the meridian lines running straight up to circle the base of their throats and connect to their shoulders. No tattoos to shape beyond the simple daggers on their inner forearms, and no intricate system of meridian lines stretching out across the rest of their body to strengthen their limbs. Judging by a quick look, those tattooed daggers couldn't be higher than C rank. None of the children would ever be powerful or influential shapers. But if they passed the test, at least they would be shapers. As for Hiral...
"No, stop thinking like that."
Still, compared to the full set of meridian lines connecting Hiral from scalp to toes, and the multitude of S-rank tattoos painstakingly etched into his skin, they were practically naked. And yet they looked at him with pity and disdain. They didn't hide their smirks, and the one on the left end even went so far as to elbow his neighbour and whisper,
"The Everfail! Hush now!"
the eldest of the shapers said quietly, turning a quick glance on the children. Though her skin stretched and sagged from her almost 200 years, her tattoos glowed the most fiercely of all.
"Though you may have passed the physical test of giving shape to one of your tattoos, you are far from shapers, if you believe behaviour like that to be acceptable."
Her eyes turned towards Juckle and the man beside her, as if reminding them of the same fact. Juggle had the decency to look abashed until her eyes settled on Hiral again.
"Well, what are you waiting for? Let's get this over with."
She jabbed her finger towards the centre of the stadium. Hiral let the bite in her words roll off him like the warm breeze. Her attitude wasn't anything new. She'd been the same, no, worse, the year before. This time he would prove her wrong. He'd show them all he could do it, that he could pass.
"Your 10th attempt," one of the shapers said. 9 times over 9 years you've come before us and been unable to shape even the smallest thing. Not the daggers of Ensath on your wrists, the wings of Anella on your shoulder blades, neither of the ways of light or shadow, nor the waters of Frey, or the fuel,"
the eldest shaper said softly. The shaper who'd been listing off Hiral's past attempts gave a small bow of his head to the elder.
"No offence intended, Ilrolic. I'm merely curious as to why this initiate, this man,
ever fail,"
one of the children snickered, but straightened at a sharp look from Ilrolic.
"As to why he thinks this, his 10th test, will be any different,"
Viewer went on, as if the child hadn't spoken at all. Hiral waited for a small nod of Irolik's head before he answered. "I've trained extensively for the year since my last test, and my father has finished the last of the tattoos on my..."
"The Spear of Clouds is finished?"
one of the quiet shapers interrupted.
"Truly?"
"Yes," Hiral said slowly. "He finished it within the last pass, and the bandages came off."
"Yes, yes, yes, you heal slowly,"
the not-so-quiet-anymore shaper said, striding out from the rest and right up to Hiral.
"We know. Just show us the spear."
"I wasn't planning on shaping the spear," Hiral said, and the shaper waved a quick hand to dismiss the thought.
Of course you weren't. Nobody has been able to shape it in thousands of passes, despite how many hopefuls have it inked. The odds of you bringing out more than a puff of light in the vague shape of the spear is so small I would never...
He trailed off at a slight cough from Erolic.
Ahem, yes. Let's see it, then.
I don't... This isn't why I'm here, Hiral said, looking at the man.
Please, humour us,
Hiralic said, coming up beside the other shaper.
Your father's work is masterful, and to finally see his rendition of the S-ranked Spear of Clouds is a treat for us. We will proceed with your test after that.
Hiral's eyes went to Lone, and the man gave a small nod as he and the other shapers walked over and encircled Hiral.
As usual, Lone said, Master Dorin's work is exceptional. It took my breath away the first time I saw it. Hiral, if you would.
He gestured to the wide swaths of cloth over Hiral's shoulders. Even the initiates crept over as Hiral slid the shoulders of the ceremonial robe down his arms so they hung loosely by the tight belt around his waist.
Well, where?
Vuel started to ask, but the gasp from one of the shapers behind Hiral had the whole group moving around behind him. Predictably, there were 12 more sharp intakes of breath as the others joined the first. Hiral stayed perfectly still as their eyes became glued to the spear tattooed up the length of his spine. The less he moved, the sooner this would all be over so he could take the test.
The detail. Amazing,
Juckel said in barely a whisper, and fingers traced down Hiral's back.
Master Dorin has truly outdone himself with this,
Ilrolik said.
His work is usually so small, but the scope of this has allowed for unprecedented detail. The spear almost looks like it could shape itself with the faintest application of power.
There has never been a more perfect version of the Spear of Clouds, I dare say, Lone agreed. Other than the original, I would imagine. Though, since none of us has ever actually seen it, perhaps my statement holds some truth.
It does. It does,
Ilrolik said, as more fingers ran along Hiral's back.
My test, he asked, turning to face the semicircle of gawkers.
Such a waste,
Jokil said with a shake of her head.
If Master Dorin is capable of this, I should go talk to him about getting... It'll do you no better,
Vuel quickly interrupted.
You don't have the solar absorption rate or capacity necessary to shape a tattoo of that rank. None of us do, other than...
All eyes turned to Hiral, more than half the people scowling out of jealousy, the other half out of disappointment.
Next year, he'll have the Emperor's greatsword tattooed,
Vuel started, trailing off until Rolik's hand on his shoulder.
Let us begin your test, Hiral,
the old shaper said.
And just in case you forgot what it is you're trying to do,
Vuel said, and nodded at the 6 young initiates, most of them less than half Hiral's age.
Shape,
he commanded them. Almost as one, the 6 children touched the dagger tattoos on the insides of the left forearms with the fingers of their right hands. The suns on their chests glowed faintly, and as they pulled their right hands away, glowing light, almost like smoke, flowed from their dagger tattoos for several seconds before solidifying into life-size versions of the weapons. None of their output rates could be higher than E-rank with how long the shaping took, but that was still infinitely higher than Hiral's.
Well done, initiates,
Vuel said, before turning his attention back to Hiral.
The minimum expected of a shaper. 9 times you have...
He stopped with a glance at Ilrolik, then started again fresh.
Your turn.
Hiral nodded and took a deep breath,
focusing on the solar energy stored within his body. It flowed through him like a raging river, the S-rank power, his potential, just waiting to be tapped and shaped. All he had to do was draw it through the tattoo of his choice to prove to them he could be a shaper. The spear of clouds running the length of his spine, the weapon said to have separated the ground from the sky itself, was too much for him at this point. As much as he hated to admit it, it was beyond him for the moment, as were most of his other tattoos. Sure, they were all technically S-rank, but with the level of detail his father had put into them, they should more likely be classified above that. No, like the other initiates in front of him, Hiral's best bet and biggest chance of success lay in the first tattoos he'd received, the daggers on his forearms. With another deep breath, he moved the fingers of his right hand to the tattoo of a dagger on the inside of his left forearm. Unlike the simple things held in the hands of the initiates, daggers that look like things of simple metal, the tattoo on his wrist was a weapon seemingly made of water. Blade and hilt both. It was one of a pair, with the other sitting on his right wrist. Together, the daggers of Ensath were said to have slain a beast of fire threatening to burn the world to cinders. Beautiful. Powerful. Deadly. The wall between Hiral and his dreams.
"The same tattoo you tried in your first test?" Vuel asked.
"Back to basics," Hiral said, not really paying attention to what his mouth was saying, as he instead focused on pulling the solar energy in his body out through the tattoo. Nothing happened. Stomach flipping at the memory of all his past failures, Hiral pushed it back down and focused harder on the tattoo. The energy was there, waiting for him to call on it, just like when he used the status window. So he called as hard as he could, pushing his will and everything he had into shaping the dagger. Still nothing.
"Whenever you're ready," Vuel said,
and Hiral glanced up to see the shaper focused on cleaning the dirt out from under his fingernails.
"Just visualizing," Hiral said, and spared a look at Lone.
The man gave Hiral a nod of encouragement, but there was a tightness around his eyes. Unlike the other shapers, Lone wanted Hiral to pass, but he didn't really believe it any more likely than the others. All the more reason Hiral couldn't fail. He lowered his eyes to focus on the one thing he needed to do.
"Come on,"
he practically screamed in his mind at the energy in his body. It was everywhere in him, in every muscle and bone. It was so much a part of him it practically glowed, but never once came when he called, like something was blocking it. If the solar energy in his body was a river, then there was a dam obstructing it somewhere, and that meant one thing. He needed to rip it right down. More focus. More pulling. His fingers drove into the skin of his wrist as he willed the energy to come through. His eyes squeezed shut as something wet and warm ran down his wrist.
"Hiral,"
Lone said quietly, but Hiral blocked out his words.
It was right there, literally on the tips of his fingers.
A flash behind his eyes hit him at the same time a jolt of searing pain ripped through his body and dropped him straight to the ground. His head bounced off the warm stone, as darkness clouded his sight from all sides, and a single child's voice filled his ears.
"Everfail."
Chapter 2. Definitely next year. Hiral groaned as sensations overcame the darkness, and his eyes flickered open. Pain, or was it the memory of pain, shot through his body, and then faded away almost as quickly. What in the Fallen's names had happened?
"You're awake."
Lone's voice drifted over to Hiral's ears, and the large man shortly followed, leaning over to look at Hiral's face. Fingers thicker than sausages pried Hiral's eyes wide, and Lone looked at each long and hard before finally leaning out of Hiral's line of sight.
"Bring up your status window, and let's see if any lasting damage was done."
"Lasting damage?" Still, Hiral didn't say anything, pulling up the window for Lone with a thought.
Your attributes look fine, though I really wonder about these intelligence and wisdom scores after that stunt. And this? What's this down here?"
Lone pointed at a notification near the bottom of Hiral's window. "Overcharge attempt. Unsuccessful. Debuff applied. System shock. System shock. No class abilities can be used for 1 hour. 174 seconds remaining."
"No class abilities can be..."
Hiral started, then barked out a short laugh. He didn't even have a class for abilities.
"This isn't something to laugh about, Hiral,"
Lone said, more seriously than Hiral would have expected.
"I've heard of others triggering this overcharge. It maximizes solar output for a brief moment, but comes with risks. At best, nothing happens. More likely, people suffer this debuff, and their internal solar pathways are shut down, so they can't be damaged further. At the worst, though, well, people completely lose their ability to utilize solar energy. And before you wonder if that's maybe what happened to you, they can't even use their status window anymore. Try to avoid doing that again."
Hiral nodded, but mention of the solar output rate turned his attention to that section of his status window. He'd felt something when he overcharged, but apparently it wasn't enough. Output rate. Unavailable.
"Go ahead and close the window," Lone instructed, and Hiral followed suit,
more than happy to ignore those cursed words while his eyes refocused on his surroundings. The ceiling of the room told him he wasn't in the testing arena anymore, and the cot beneath him was uncomfortably familiar. Back in Lone's training compound, Hiral turned to the question that had been rattling around his head since he opened his eyes, the one he couldn't work up the nerve to voice. "Did I pass?" A second of silence, then two, three.
"No," Lone finally said. "I thought you'd had it. Something stirred inside of you, obviously the overcharge, and your eyes flashed like your power was finally coming out."
"And then?" Hiral asked, when Lone didn't seem like he'd continue on his own.
"Then you collapsed, blood coming out of your ears, and your body shaking in seizure. Even Fuel looked worried."
Lone chuckled, then caught himself as Hiral squeezed his eyes shut.
"I'm sorry, Hiral. Can you move?"
Despite what had happened, Hiral swung his legs off the cot and pulled himself up to a sitting position. The room spun for a second, but quickly settled, and he ran his hand through his hair. A good thing he hadn't cut it, after all.
"How do you feel?"
Lone asked, seated across the small room in his large wooden chair. Hiral's eyes settled on his bandage-wrapped wrist, the red of blood soaking lightly through.
"I failed. Again,"
he said quietly, something in his chest contracting so much it felt like his whole body would collapse on itself.
"Ever fail?"
The whisper in a childlike voice echoed in his ears over and over, and he saw the other initiates laughing at him as he closed his eyes. Another year. Another fiasco while other children, half his age, succeeded where he failed. Another embarrassment. Another shame to his family. He leaned forward, elbows on his knees, and dropped his hands into his face. 10 times.
10.
10 years, and he hadn't been able to shape a single thing. Not once.
What was wrong with him?
"What will you do?"
Lone asked softly. The same thing he'd asked last year, and the year before that. Hiral squeezed his eyes shut as hard as he could, the tops of his fingers digging into his scalp under his hair, and he took a deep breath. Holding the air in his lungs, he squeezed everything, pushing all his frustration to its peak, and then let it all out with his breath. Raising his head, he looked at Lone. I'll try again next year. The expression on Lone's face didn't shift even a little. You're sure? Something was different this time, Hiral said. I felt something. I'm getting closer to a breakthrough. I'll get it next time.
Hiral, the blood coming out of places it wasn't supposed to is what was different. Are you sure you should keep pushing?
Yes, Hiral interrupted. If I give up now, what will the last 10 years have meant? They'll all have been nothing but a waste. I have to succeed or...
Hiral trailed off and looked away from his teacher.
Do you want to find another instructor?
Lone asked evenly. Hiral shook his head immediately. No, you stood by me all this time. The problem isn't you, it's me. Besides, nobody else would take me on as a student, he added, only half joking.
Hiral, maybe...
Lone cut off as the door to the room cracked open and Hiral's father poked his head in.
I heard voices,
the man said, opening the door all the way and stepping in.
Elazad,
Lone said, using Hiral's father's first name. With a small nod to Lone, Elazad came over to crouch in front of Hiral. He took Hiral's right hand in his, putting a thumb over Hiral's wrist and nodding in time with the heartbeat he felt. Then he turned his attention to his son's left wrist and the bandages there.
The dagger failed you again.
I'm sorry.
It's not... You didn't... You don't have to be... You saw?
Hiral started and stopped until he finally got a question out.
Of course I did. I wouldn't miss your testing.
Did Mum?
Elisand's eyes drifted to the side, then back toward Hiral.
Your mother had important work she couldn't get away from today.
I understand, Hiral said, the words somehow stinging, despite him knowing they were coming. His mother hadn't come to a test since he'd failed his first. Why would she have come to this one? It was better, really. One less person for him to embarrass. It'd be bad enough when word of his 10th failure left the testing grounds.
Who was he kidding? It was likely already all over the island and probably all the way down to the nomads by now.
Let me take a look at your meridian lines. Maybe I made a mistake somewhere when I was inking them,
Elazad said, turning over Hiral's arm. Starting with the circle on the back of Hiral's hand, Elazad followed the thumb-thick line up to the circular node on Hiral's elbow, then continued up the connecting line toward Hiral's shoulder.
Dad,
Hiral said, trying to pull his arm away from his father's grip, but the man was always surprisingly strong for an artist.
You've checked my meridian lines every year. You didn't make any mistakes when you inked me. Even the shapers at the test marveled at the work you do. You're the best there is. There is nothing wrong with my tattoos.
Your mother might disagree with part of that. Did I hear you say you'll be trying again next year?
Elazad glanced back down at Hiral's bloody wrist.
Yes, Hiral said simply, meeting his father's eyes. You could come work with me, you know,
Elazad said predictably.
You don't have to be a shaper.
I can't be an artist. Can't take that class, Hiral said, pulling his wrist back and crossing his arms to hide the bandage. You know my blood doesn't mix with the ink. I can't do what you do.
Maybe the test was wrong, Elazad said. Being an artist would explain why you can't shape.
Hiral looked across the bare skin of his father's arms. Toned from hard work, yes, and with the same meridian lines all makers had, but completely bereft of any other tattoos. His father, the most skilled artist in the city, like any artist, couldn't shape tattoos into reality. The two classes were mutually exclusive. But at least he had a reason he couldn't shape, unlike Hiral, who was just a failure. He couldn't shape, couldn't inscribe, couldn't even pass the same test 9-year-olds were breezing through. Everfail, indeed. "I'll try again next year," Hiral said, mainly to drown out the echoing children's voices in his head. "And the year after that, if I have to, until I pass. I will be a shaper. It's what I was meant to be." Elazad opened his mouth to speak, then closed it again, stood up, and put his hand on Hiral's shoulder. "And I'll be in the stands watching until you do." "Lone?" Elazad turned to the shaper. "You'll keep working with him?"
"I will," Lone said. "Once he cracks the wall holding him back, he'll make them all regret their words."
Nobody in the room needed to specify who they were. Everybody.
"Well, how about we go find something to eat then? You must be hungry," Elazad said, breaking the dark silence.
"How long was I unconscious?" Hiral asked, instead of answering.
"About an hour," Lone said. "You sure you're feeling okay? We cleaned you up, but without knowing what caused that..."
"An hour? Fallen's balls," he cursed, then coughed at the glare from his father.
"I have to get over to the port."
"The port?" Elazad asked. "Work," Hiral said, pushing himself to his feet smoothly. His limbs were stiff, and despite what he'd told the others, the pain wasn't completely gone. Good thing he'd become so good at faking he was okay over the last 10 years.
"Scheduled for a trade run down to the Nomads." "Arty would understand if you didn't make it today," Elazad said. "I know this new place that just opened up. Been smelling the bread every morning on my way to the studio."
"Dad," Hiral said evenly, "nobody other than Arty will hire me. If I lose this job, what am I going to do until I become a shaper? Besides, it'll distract me. I need that right now.
And you, if you've been here for the hour waiting for me to wake up, you must have clients lining up at your door. Do you really think Yana would appreciate you coming back any later than you already are?"
Elazad winced at his receptionist's name, but nodded.
"You make a good point. Look, fine, you win. But I'm bringing bread home tonight to go with dinner, so don't you dare fill up on some port market junk food."
"I'm going to work, Dad, not to shop," Hiral said. He turned to Lone and gave a bow.
"I'm sorry I let you down again. Thank you for continuing to support me long after anybody else would have given up on me."
Lone coughed, the sound muffled, like he'd put his hand in front of his mouth, then cleared his throat.
"When I took you on as a student, it was because I saw the potential in you. Not just the potential the measure saw when they put that crystal in your chest and your status window came up for the first time."
He touched his own chest, where his crystal was embedded under his sun tattoo.
"You had a look in your eyes, still do, that spoke to me. Something I don't see in a lot of initiates. Most of the children who walk through my doors act like they are entitled to become shapers, just because the measure and their status window said they had a little bit of potential when they were born. Even though only about 1 in 10 of the people who come take the test actually have what it takes, they all assume they are that one. Not you, though," Lone continued. "You told me you'd earn your place among the shapers and work as hard as you needed to. Even if it's turned out to be a bit harder than either of us expected, it hasn't changed my opinion of you. I know you'll succeed, and I'll be there with you
when you do.
Just to rub it in Vuel's face?
Hiral wisecracked to keep down the emotions bubbling in his chest. He could break down later, both at his own failure and the undeserved support, but for now, he had to keep it together. Keep faking. For them and himself.
Might be part of it,
Lone said, his voice a little hoarse, and he coughed into his hand again.
Didn't you say you had work to get to? The port isn't close, even for somebody with your dexterity. And you can't be planning to go down to the nomads, dressed like that.
Hiral straightened and looked at his arms, the meridian lines and tattoos still dark against his skin, then shook his head. No, he definitely couldn't go down looking like that.
You're right. I need to get home and change first, Hiral said to the two men, his father so normal size compared to the gigantic shaper. If you'll excuse me.
Go on, then, Lone said, his big thumb running along the bottom of one of his eyes.
I'll see you at home, Elizad said, obviously not planning to leave with Hiral.
Don't keep Yana waiting any longer than you need to,
Hiral said, but ducked out the door before his father could respond. He put his hand on the knob and gently pulled it closed as his father's whispered words crept out behind him.
Do you think he has a chance at it next year?
Hiral closed the door before he could hear Lone's answer, then ran away from there as quickly as his legs would carry him. Chapter 3 Time Trial. Hiral checked up and down the hall, clear in both directions, then opened the door and slipped in before anybody noticed him. Quickly closing the door, he leaned back against it and gently banged his head. Once, twice, three times. He'd only told a partial lie to Lone and his father. He did need to get to the port for work, but not quite as soon as he'd suggested. He still had a couple of hours before Artie was expecting him, and after the test, he needed to vent some frustration. It was that, or collapse in a corner and completely shut down. Why couldn't he just do it like everybody else could? Why did he have to be the Everfail? Why was he broken? Hiral pushed off from the door and walked down the narrow hall, pounding the bottom of his fist against the stone wall every few steps. He'd worked so hard, trained every day, read all the books and done every exercise he and Lone could think of. And it still hadn't been enough. 20 feet and an endless stream of internal insults later, Hiral exited the hallway into what looked like a small waiting room. A crystal sat on a pedestal in the middle of the room, a plain wall beyond it. Looking at the pedestal, he almost turned around and left again. He'd planned to have a class the next time he came here, but apparently that wasn't in the cards this year.
Nothing for it, then,
he mumbled to himself with a sigh, then stepped forward and put his hand against the crystal. Luckily, it didn't require an input of solar energy. Otherwise, he wouldn't have been able to use the interface, even though the system shock debuff had faded. Not even a second later, a blue screen similar to Hiral's status window materialized in the air above the pedestal. Fallen Reach Training Room. Time Trial. Difficulty. E rank. Top scores. Hiral Dorin. 1 minute, 1 second. Hiral Dorin. 1 minute, 2 seconds. Hiral Dorin. 1 minute, 3 seconds. Attempt time trial? Yes, no. Hiral scratched at his cheek while he looked at his previous times. So close to breaking the 1 minute mark, and he'd hoped having the stat boosts from his meridian lines after getting his class would make the difference. If any shapers actually came down to the training room, one of them would have shattered his records without even really trying. It was only because they all preferred sparring up in the amphitheatre that Hiral's name was on there at all.
Ah, whatever, Hiral said,
tapping the yes icon hanging in the air. Fallen reached training room. Time trial selected. Choose difficulty. Low, medium, high. Hiral tapped high, and the blue window faded at the same time blue energy swirled in front of him like some kind of doorway. He rolled his wrist a few times to make sure the injury and bandage didn't get in the way. Little tight, he could deal with it. Then stepped through the portal into the next room. As soon as he passed through, the portal closed, and another blue window popped up to his left. Begin? Yes. The lack of a no option always made Hiral chuckle, but he took a moment to check out the course ahead of him before he hit yes while he took his sandals off. As always, the first 100 feet had triangular islands suspended above water, and then a slowly spinning disc immediately after. When he'd first done the course, he'd had to leap onto each triangle and grab the top, and then, only after catching his balance again, leap to the next and repeat. Then again, he'd only had 10 dexterity at the time. Still, falling meant swimming, and there was no way he'd crack 1 minute if he got wet. Even with his higher dexterity of 20, he couldn't get cocky now. The moving disc would have 3 opponents to defeat, generated somehow by the training room itself, and then a new path would open. His best times had come when the 3 enemies were thin but fast. The ones who carried stupidly large shields always ruined his run, even though they opened the easier of the 2 paths. Hiral took a deep breath, blew it back out slowly, and repeated the process 2 more. At least the familiarity of the training room helped keep his mind off the test. Of course, as soon as he realized that, he slapped the yes button before his brain could get in his way, then dashed straight ahead as soon as a glowing blue begin appeared in the air. 10 feet, and he was up to a full sprint. 15, and he changed his angle slightly. 20 feet, and he leapt from the platform to the first triangular island ahead and to the right, his foot barely hitting the incline before he pushed off towards the next slanted island, 3 feet ahead and to his left. Left, right, left, right, left, right. He bounded back and forth between the triangular islands, his feet only touching them long enough for his leg to bend and then spring him off again. With his high dexterity and hundreds of times running the obstacle course, almost all of his momentum kept him racing forward. A handful of seconds later, he was halfway to the spinning disc, and 3 red icons appeared in the air above it.
Fallen's luck! Red means shields!
Nothing to do but keep going, Hiral bounded back and forth between the islands until he leapt from the final one to the spinning disc. Tucking into a roll to absorb some momentum as soon as he landed, Hiral popped to his feet at the same time 3 red humanoid constructs of solid light started appearing with shields as tall as they were. A couple good hits were enough to bring them down. They didn't have much health if he could get around the shields, but the shields themselves completely negated any damage they blocked.
I need to try something different.
Hiral moved in the second it took the opponents to fully solidify, darting toward the one on his left, then swept out and around the shield. Suddenly behind the red shield bearer, he could probably land enough blows to bring it down from that angle. But there was another idea he needed to try. Instead of lashing out with a kick to a vulnerable flank, he instead rushed in and wrapped his arms around the shield bearer's waist, then hauled up with all his 18 strength. Far lighter than expected, Hiral's opponent went up and over as he bridged his back, slamming the red head to the stone with an echoing crack. Knowing the other 2 would already be moving, Hiral gave a gentle push, and the momentum of the shield bearer's legs carried it over the edge of the disc to fall into the water.
Ah, no. If it isn't...
One of the red icons above the disc vanished at the same time he kicked up to his feet.
Wait, did it vanish because of the damage I did or because it fell into the water? That could mean...
Hiral spun to face the other 2, who were already shield rushing straight at him.
He'd learned the hard way they could shove him right off the disc if they hit him, so he'd always fought them near the centre of the spinning platform. But it was time for a new plan. Bending his knees, Hiral set his feet and forced himself to be patient as the shield-bearers charged. They moved fast, but it still felt like it took them an eternity to corner him on the edge of the platform. And then they both twisted their shields so they held them horizontally instead of vertically. The move exposed their heads. It'd still take more than a single blow to put them down, but also completely cut off any escape routes along the disc. Suddenly, with nowhere to go, Hiral took a step back, the heel of his left foot hanging off the edge of the platform. The shield-bearers charged in, intent on pushing him over the side, even if they went with him. When they came so close, Hiral could touch the shields if he reached out. He bent his knees and then leapt straight up, hands extended for the shield-bearer's shoulders. Feet just barely clearing the rushing shields, Hiral pushed himself off the shoulders towards the centre of the disc. That slight nudge was all his opponents needed, and they went tumbling into the water. Still, his landing wasn't as graceful as it could have been, and he stumbled and fell to his hands and knees, losing precious seconds while he twisted to look at the red icons hovering above him. Both winked out. With no time to waste, Hiral pushed himself to his feet and spun to orient himself, eyes peeled for the path that would open. There! He was on the wrong side of the disc, but that gave him a chance to build up speed as a wall on one side of the hall lifted to reveal a narrow balance beam. 50 feet long and only as wide as the palm of Hiral's hand, it was still no match for his dexterity, and he vaulted onto it without hesitation, ran along it as easily as a normal floor, and then jumped to the next platform without slowing. As soon as he landed, however, he paused to peer down into what would be best described as a moving jigsaw puzzle pit. Blocks all along the 20-foot depths of the pit moved back and forth, sliding along one wall and then hovering across the opening to sink into the opposite. Originally designed for racers to leap down block by block, Hiral instead waited for the familiar pattern and then simply jumped into the middle of the pit. Arms tight at his side, and through a space not much wider than his shoulders, Hiral dropped straight between the shifting blocks to land on the next platform below, crouching down to absorb some of the impact, then launching forward like a sprinter. The long hallway, bare by all appearances, stretched a good 200 feet ahead of him, but he immediately went over to run along the right wall. No sooner than he'd covered 15 feet, arm-thick poles rotated out of the wall on his left, pushing just past the middle of the hall, but not quite far enough to whack Hiral. 1, 2, 3, 4 poles swung out at varying heights, and then Hiral dove forward over another bar that rose out of the floor and went from wall to wall at shin height. Easily clearing the tripping bar, Hiral tucked his shoulder and rolled under another bar that dropped from the ceiling. Up and to his feet again, he only lost half a step, then ran against the left wall as more bars swung out from the right towards the centre of the hall. Part of him would have felt guilty at the way he almost cheated by memorising the movements of the time trial, except he'd also gained just as many mental stat point increases from the training as he had physical. If anything, he was supposed to learn and memorise the course's obstacles to get the best time. 2 more shifts from side to side, a quick jaunt of hopping, and 1 final tuck and roll got him to the end of the tunnel. Sliding under the last bar, Hiral popped to his feet as 3 blue icons appeared in the centre of the walled room. Not even waiting for the 3 thin constructs to form, he dashed at where he knew one would emerge. The instant its outline appeared, he skidded to a stop and launched a quick barrage of blows. Kidney punch, liver punch, right hook across the blue jaw, and the construct was gone. Shifting his weight, Hiral spun around on his lead foot, bringing his left arm up just in time to catch a high kick aimed for the side of his head on his bandages. Because of his 18 strength and endurance, he didn't even budge from the impact. Instead, He leaned his weight on his back foot and raised his right foot, narrowly avoiding the sweeping kick from the other blue construct he knew was coming. Like he was just stepping over the low kick, Hiral dropped his foot back to the ground as soon as it was passed, simultaneously reaching up and hooking the high-kicking leg as it tried to retract. Turning as he grabbed the leg, a shoulder bump to the blue fighter stole its balance, and then Hiral hauled in the other direction. With a solid grip on the leg, his strength was more than enough to lift it completely off its one foot, and he swung it around to slam into its partner. The two blue bodies crashed to the floor in a tangle of limbs, and Hiral dove on top of them in a flurry of punches that first dispelled the top fighter and then the bottom one almost immediately after. Lacking even the time to take a deep breath, Hiral was back on his feet and sprinting towards a wall just now raising. Before it reached the ceiling, he was already in the air, leaping for the two bars attached to the wall above another water-filled hallway. His lead foot touched down perfectly on the lower of the bars, about the same level as the floor he'd just left, while his hand reached out to barely touch the bar at shoulder height. Just inches from the wall, and no wider than the balance beam had been, Hiral quick-stepped along the lower bar, using his hand as a guide and nothing more. When he reached the end of the 15-foot path, he leapt across the 8-foot hall to more bars on the other wall. Faster! Hiral devoured the 15 feet on this bar and sprang across the hall to the next set, bare feet slapping with each step. 5 feet before the end, he eased up on his mad sprint and focused on the coming trial. The horizontal bars coming weren't a challenge by themselves, but he'd learned the hard way that if he jumped to them with too much momentum, it'd mess up his rhythm and slow him down in the long run. Step, step, leap, and Hiral caught the first horizontal bar with his right hand, his forward momentum swinging his legs well above the water below. Still, he hit them with a bit too much speed, and his only chance was to reach! Hiral extended his left arm past the next bar, and instead reached for the bar after that, just barely snagging it with his fingers. Without a full grip on it, it'd be a risk to let go with his right hand, but to have any hope of breaking 1 minute, he'd need to take a chance and trust his endurance. Here goes. He let go with his right hand, letting his inertia swing him around on the fingers of his left hand, while he brought his right back around and reached for the next bar. So close! Got it! With a secure grip, Hiral fell into his usual powerful rhythm to swing from bar to bar. Almost there. Only the rope left. 15 bars in total, barely a few seconds to get across them all, and Hiral reached for the last one while snapping his legs forward. Up and outward he sailed across the 3 feet of empty air to catch the rope hanging down through the last vertical part of the course. By the time he had gotten here during the first 100 runs or so of the time trial, his arms had been burning to the point the 50-foot climb seemed almost impossible. Today, he barely noticed it as he tucked his feet around the rope and began the hand-over-hand climb. What's the time? Am I going to make it? Hiral pulled himself up in what felt like record time, a small swing and jump getting him back onto solid ground before he lunged out and tapped on the floating blue finish hanging in the air. Leaning forward and taking deep breaths, he waited the prerequisite 6 seconds before he got the result. It was almost as though whoever had designed the time trial wanted to add a small flair of drama. Fallen reached time trial. Complete. New record. Hiral's breath caught at the mention of a new record, but then he blew out the air in his lungs with an annoyed sigh. Time? 1 minute, 0 seconds. Well, he had improved his time, but just like the Shaper test, it wasn't enough. His new time, along with his old, hovered in front of him, along with a new prompt. Try again. Exit. Hiral ran his hands through his hair while he breathed out. He'd made progress, but it still felt like he'd failed again, and the child's mocking voice flitted through his mind over and over.
Everfail, Everfail, Everfail.
He slapped his hand on the try again button, and another portal opened up to where he'd started his last run. I will do this, he grumbled, then started the course all over again. Chapter 4. What's wrong with me? Hiral put his hands on his knees, then leaned back against the wall in the shade of his home's overhanging roof as he sucked in air. Sure, maybe he hadn't needed to sprint all the way home after 2 hours of running the obstacle course, but as soon as he'd left the time trial and the first set of eyes fell on his tattoos, then his small size, the whispers had started. No shaper had as many tattoos as he did, without being almost 7 feet tall from their constant use of the energy gifted by the sun. Only one person in the entire city, on the entire island, fit his description. Everfail, he whispered to himself as he shook his head, eyes landing on the tattoos, covering his sweat-sheen skin. Fallen's balls. Even the fact he was sweating with that many tattoos made him stand out. Sure, his endurance was higher than most E-rankers because of his constant training, even without a class. But a shaper with that many tattoos would be at least D-rank, with 3 times the endurance stat. Sweating and out of breath? No way. He hadn't even gotten a sub-minute run for all his trouble. He'd managed to tie his best time twice more, but the rest of the runs were abysmal, despite him having figured out the best way to deal with the red shield bearers when they popped up. Maybe after his work with Artie, he'd hit it up again. Or maybe he should wait a few passes. That was a question for later. He did actually need to get to work now. He couldn't go to the port dressed like this, with everybody watching him, whispering. Time to lose the ceremonial outfit and put on something a little less revealing. Then he had to get to work. He hadn't been lying when he said nobody else would hire him. He couldn't afford to lose this job, even if there really wasn't any good reason Artie had hired him in the first place. He's just taking pity on me, Hiral told himself for the 100th time, then straightened and walked around to the back door of the building, still sucking in air through his teeth. The stitch in his side ached like somebody had stuck their hand in and ripped something out, and he rubbed his abdomen as he scanned the wide backyard to make sure his mother wasn't out there tending to her hobby garden. When he thankfully didn't see her, he scooted around to quietly push the door open.
You're terrible at being sneaky,
his younger sister said as he peeked his head in.
The deep breathing right outside the studio window. I thought some creeper had come looking for me while I was home alone.
Hey, Nat, Hiral said, carefully stepping through the door and looking around.
Mum's not home, if that's who you're looking for,
Nat said, from where she leaned against the studio doorframe, arms crossed.
Nobody but you and me.
Hiral let out a sigh of relief. One less thing for him to deal with right now.
You don't look like you're in the mood for celebrating,
Nat said, and Hiral looked up to find concern in her eyes. She stepped away from the wall and came over to wrap her arms around his chest. Even though she was only 3 years younger than him, she was small for her age, and her head settled just below his chin.
Want to talk about it?
She asked, ignoring how damp he had to be against the side of her face. You can probably guess, he said, fighting to keep the bitterness out of his voice.
I'm sorry I couldn't make it. I had a test in class and I...
It's okay, Hiral said, and gave her a hug. Your classes are important. You're going to be the next Master Dorin, if even half of what I'm hearing is true. Nat stepped back out of the hug, blushing, and shook her head.
It's not like that.
Hiral mussed his little sister's hair, almost as long as his own. Don't sell yourself short just because I had a rough day. I need some good news before I get cleaned up and head to work. How did your test go?
Good, I think,
Nat said, walking upstairs with him as she talked.
Won't have the results until later today, but it was just a messaging tattoo. They wanted us to do the bird of twittering. That bird is so boring, though, and there are too many limits on how long the message can be. So I decided to do...
Two minds as one, Hiral interrupted, and Nat blushed again. Nat, that's an A-rank tattoo for a test that was calling for a D-rank. If you didn't do it perfectly, they can't even give you partial marks.
I did do it perfectly, she said as they got to the door to Hiral's room. Better than perfectly. You should have seen it.
Hiral smiled at his little sister. He couldn't help it. She was just so perfect. Everything their parents could want in a child. Smart and determined, which was why she was a level 17 E-rank artist. Just 3 levels shy of breaking through to D-rank, even at her age. Not to mention she was funny, and judging by the number of boys who came by looking for her, pretty as well. And somehow, Hiral couldn't begrudge her for it, even on his worst day of the year, because she dropped everything she was doing to check on him. Dad's bringing home bread tonight to go with dinner from some new shop that opened up. Will you have the results by then? Hiral asked her.
I should, Nat said.
Perfect. I've got work, but I should be back by then. There's a cake shop at the port. I'll grab something to celebrate you passing your test. Nat smiled up at him, eyes practically sparkling. The girl loved cake. But then a shadow passed over her face, and the smile vanished.
Maybe we shouldn't. It's not a big deal. Just a small test.
Hiral forced a smile on his own face, as easy as putting on a pair of pants.
Don't be silly. You deserve this. Look, I've got to get ready for work, but I promise I'll be back for dinner, he said, putting his hand on the doorknob to his room. Hiral, Nat said quietly. Do you want me to ink a lower rank tattoo on you? Do you think it would help you? I mean, you know, next year.
Hiral's fingers tightened around the doorknob, but he managed to keep the smile on his face. I appreciate the offer, Nat. I really do. But if you put anything less than S rank on my body, it would lower the potency of all my tattoos. All of Mum and Dad's hard work would be gone. All tattoos share the potency of the weakest tattoo. Isn't that the third tenet of being an artist?
I know, but what's the point of having S rank and above tattoos if you can't...
Nat snapped her mouth shut before the words could come out. If I can't use them anyway. Hiral finished her sentence with the smile still on his face. Can't use them yet, he said, and mussed her hair again. Yet. I'll get there. Have a little faith in your big brother, okay?
How can you stay so positive?
She asked, her voice quiet. Same way you got to level 17, Hiral said with a wink. Hard work.
I'm almost level 18, she said, a hint of pride in her eyes. And that's kind of thanks to you. That tip about practicing without using my meridian line bonuses was a winner. Gets me more experience for every tattoo I do, and makes leveling easy. Almost feels like cheating. How did you figure that out anyway?
Just an educated guess based on some reading I'd done, he said. Anyway, I should get changed. I have to get going. She held his eyes for a few long seconds, searching for something, then finally nodded.
Yeah, but you know, if you change your mind about...
She trailed off. I know just who to talk to. Now, go get back to whatever you stopped doing to make sure I wasn't a crying wreck.
You do ugly cry when you get going.
Learn that from you, he shot back.
Bleh!
She stuck out her tongue and then forced a smile onto her face. She wasn't quite as good at it as Hiral was, but she was trying. For his sake.
He waited until she went back down the stairs before he opened the door and ducked into his quiet room. The blackout curtains were still in place, leaving him shrouded in darkness as he closed the door and then leaned against it for support. 10 times. He breathed out, his chest clenching again as he had a moment to himself, with nobody to maintain a strong face for. Sliding down to the floor, Hiral dropped his head into his hands and struggled for breath. He told Lone and his father he'd keep going until he passed, but could he really do that? Hadn't he worked hard enough, suffered enough? What else could he possibly do? What would it take to make his status window change?
I've tried everything,
he whispered, tears of anger finally bursting out from behind his eyes and running down his cheeks in a rush.
Why am I such a failure? What is wrong with me?
He drove his fingers into his scalp beneath the hair. The pain was a distant thing compared to the emotions ripping apart his chest from the inside. Hiral's heart hammered against his ribs, pounding like it wanted to get out, while the rest of his body shivered like he was under a lake of freezing water. The air he managed to suck in between his teeth barely filled his lungs, and he was already trying to breathe in more before the last breath even left. Faster and faster he gulped in air, but he didn't seem to be doing anything, and darkness deeper than the room around him clawed at his vision. Despair and rage warred within him, one telling him to give up and the other driving him back to the training room. He imagined obliterating those light constructs over and over again until he either passed the test or broke himself in the effort. Then he would stand before all who had doubted him, with a new tattoo of the Emperor's greatsword blazing in his hands, just like they mocked. What would they say then? What would they... Hiral tried to focus on that image, but it slipped away. After all, he had destroyed the constructs in the training room, enough of them to fill an entire army. And if that hadn't helped for 10 tests, how would it help for 11? He couldn't do it. Just couldn't. A door closed somewhere downstairs, probably the front door from the sound of it, and Hiral forced his lungs to stop their spasmed gasping. Who was it? The bottom stair creaked, somebody starting up to the second level. If it was his other youngest sister, Millie, she'd come right to his room to ask how he'd done on the test. Wouldn't even knock. He couldn't let her see him like this. Somehow, his need to appear okay snapped him out of the downward spiral enough to push himself to his feet. Another creak. That'd be the middle landing, and Hiral staggered away from the wall towards his small bathroom. She'd come barging in, but if he was in the shower, even she would leave him alone. Probably. Legs heavy and hands still shaking, Hiral shouldered his bathroom door open, then kicked it closed with the heel of his foot. Without even pulling the ceremonial robes off, he stumbled into the small enclosed corner of the room and passed his hand over the flat crystal embedded in the wall. Streams of hot water came gushing out of the ceiling above him.
Hiral, you in here?
Millie called from inside his room.
Oh, you're in the shower? Come find me when you're done.
Hiral held his breath, waiting, just in case, to see if she'd come in anyway. She didn't quite get how privacy worked. Well, at least not anybody's other than her own. When the bathroom door stayed closed, Hiral finally leaned his head back and let the hot water flow over him. Was he broken? Would he ever be able to shape anything? Or was he really Everfail? And if he was, then what? What would he build from his life? The falling water didn't seem to have the answer. Chapter 5. Best Friend?
Then you snuck out of the house so you didn't have to face Millie?
Gauto roared with laughter, slapping Hiral on the back.
Why are you so afraid of your sister?
Hiral glared at his best friend, though maybe best and friend were both overstatements at the moment, and ground his teeth.
You know very well why I didn't want to talk to her. Do you remember what she did the third year when I didn't pass? 6 years old, and she marched over and challenged one of the presiding shapers to a match in the amphitheatre of the sun.
Yeah, I remember that. Didn't you end up having to take her place?
Gauto asked. Hiral scowled at the memory of stepping into the amphitheatre against a full shaper. A master, B-rank shaper, no less. Right after his third failure, to boot. Embarrassing was an understatement.
Yes, and it didn't go well.
Hiral snarled enough that a couple walking past him did a double take. Actually, didn't go well was also an understatement. He'd gotten beaten so badly, the shaper wouldn't have even got class experience for it.
So, that was years ago.
She's done it 3 more times since then. Thinks it's funny. Hiral deadpanned.
Last year was kind of entertaining, Gauto said,
his fingers stroking the patchy scruff on his chin. Having a full, sagely beard to fit his new job at the academy just wasn't in the cards for him.
Venix chased you around the arena for a good 15 minutes. If you'd had your meridian line strengthening you, you would have wiped the floor with him. Still, the fact you have more dexterity than he does, and he's C rank, is kind of impressive.
Hiral glanced down at the back of his hand, though the glove and sleeve hid his tattoos from sight. Those, along with the hooded coat he wore, were generally enough to keep people from recognizing him on the street. Without the lines to harden and strengthen me like the full shapers have, staying out of the way is the best I can do. Most of them put all their points into strength and endurance, so they're pretty slow.
Well, if you ask me, it did make for a more entertaining match than most of the ones we get. Those shapers tend to just stand there and take turns hitting each other. First one to fall loses.
Like I said, strength and endurance, Hiral said. When your skin is practically indestructible and you have the strength of almost 20 average people, it does kind of make you cocky. On the other hand, shapers who avoid getting hit are seen as cowards.
Gauto glanced at Hiral, but didn't say anything. The implication was obvious.
Hiral, for his part, forced himself to look around. Anything to take his mind off the test. Like always, the day was beautiful, the sun directly above the city, and people crowded the streets. Midway between the academy where Gauto worked and the port where Hiral was headed, small stalls of goods lined the streets. They offered baked goods that made Hiral's mouth water, small toys for children, quills brought up from the nomads for the artists, though a quick glance showed their low quality, and a dozen other things. If he couldn't find what he was looking for in the port when he came back from work, he'd definitely be able to find something for Nat's celebration in the warren of shops.
When you come back up from your business with Artie, why don't you come by the academy?
Gauto asked, finally breaking the silence.
Laika and Professor Itone would love to see you. The professor asked me at least once a week if I've been able to convince you to join us. He says you'd make a fantastic academic.
What did you tell him? Hiral asked.
That I'd be thrilled if you joined.
Gauto chuckled.
You've got the head for it, Hiral. Your attributes are way above average, even compared to somebody who has a class. I don't know why you'd ever want to be a shaper.
You took the test too, Hiral pointed out. 3 times.
And that's when I learned where my true calling was. Turned my attention to academia, and I've never been happier.
Or chubbier, Hiral said, gently elbowing Gauto in his soft side.
We can't all be toned perfection like you, Gauto said, eyeing Hiral up and down. Though nobody would ever know, with all the layers you wear.
Stops people from noticing me, Hiral said, though he told his friend that more than once, and pulled his hood lower around his face.
Like always, the day was warm under the constant sunlight, but at least he wasn't the only one in the street dressed like that.
The only benefit I can see from all the work you do to join the Shapers is how much the ladies would appreciate your toned body under their fingers.
Not going to happen, Hiral said, forcing the smile back on his face. Most girls won't even talk to me once they realize who I am, let alone touch me. They think my inability to shape is contagious.
You're harder on yourself than anybody else's, Gauto said.
Maybe. Anyway, back to your original point. I'm not yet ready to join the academy yet, he said, choking off his own words.
Yet? Yet? Was he really considering a future that didn't involve the Shapers?
No, it was just the depression after the latest failure. He'd get it next year.
Which was the same thing he'd told himself last year.
No, he only had one chance at a class, and he needed to pass the Shaper test to get the one he wanted.
You have the stats for it, Gauto said. You enjoy the puzzle of figuring things out. I mean, come on, you love testing more than I do. You remember that time we tested how much we could magnify sunlight before it burned even a Shaper's body?
We were 12, Gauto, and the result was us getting chased by said Shaper halfway across the city.
Hiral chuckled. Why am I always getting chased by Shapers? Yeah, but I remember the smile on your face the whole way. Okay, something more recent then. Last year, when we started my thesis on the strength attribute relative to the force of a punch, it should have been a linear relationship.
No, I knew it wouldn't be, Hiral corrected. Rank reinforces the body in ways outside of just plain stats. I'm sure that's where we're seeing the change. Not to mention our natural attributes that aren't modified by meridian lines. I'm sure they also factor in differently. What we need to do is...
Hiral trailed off when he saw the huge grin on his friend's face.
See, that's what I mean. You're an academic at heart, Hiral, Gauto said, though his voice softened.
I admit, some of what academics do interests me, but being a Shaper has been my dream since I was a kid.
So you can fight in the amphitheatre? Gauto asked.
Sure, there's fame there, but also head trauma.
Not for that, and you know it. That isn't what Shapers are meant for. Shapers are supposed to be protectors, explorers.
What are you going to protect us from up here? A sunburn? Not that we can burn with anything less than 8x magnification.
Gauto chuckled again, obviously remembering the large magnifying glass that set up over the sleeping Shaper.
I've got the Disc of Passage, Hiral said. If I could use it, I could go anywhere. And I could take you with me. Think of what we could learn. And it's not just that. I've put so much work into passing the Shaper tests. Not just me either. Lone, my dad, my sisters, you. You've all supported me for so long.
He had to force the last part out.
You think giving up would be letting us down? Gauto said, and it wasn't a question. It wouldn't be. You're too smart to believe anything else.
Yeah, part of me knows that.
Ah, it's not just us. It's them, Gauto said, reading into Hiral's silence. You want to prove them all wrong? The doubters?
I do, Hiral admitted, his fist clenching at his side. Gauto, I enjoy the research with you because it's a challenge. I like pushing myself, testing my limits. I've trained with Master Lone every day for years. How to move, how to fight, for when I finally become a Shaper. I want that challenge too. I need to know how far I can go, and this, he said, gesturing his hands up and down himself, this isn't enough.
I've seen you train, Gauto said, a twinkle in his eye. So when you finally get your class, I hope you do spend a few days in the amphitheatre. You're going to be a terror, and that's a show I'll happily pay to see.
I've got a few scores to settle, don't I?
I don't think a few is usually counted in the dozens, but yeah, something like that, Gauto said. Anyway, at least come by and take a look at our newest discovery when you come back up.
What did you find? Hiral asked, happy to move the conversation along. His friend was only looking out for him. He always had, but it was still hard to talk about.
Some old rooms underground, like a catacomb or something under the city, Gauto said, the excitement of it infecting his voice. Rooms? Underground? How in the Fallen's names did you get approval to dig?
We didn't, Gauto said.
Somebody was doing renovations on their home in the east end of the city. Floor gave out from the work, and they found the secret room underneath. Called us right away.
The floor gave out? That's unusual. But was the room empty?
Catacombs under the city? Amazing. How had they stayed hidden all this time?
No, Gauto said, his eyebrows doing a little dance up and down his forehead.
You're going to make me ask, aren't you? I'm going to make you come see if you want to know.
Not interested, Hiral lied, but he had a lot of practice making people believe what he said, and Gauto's eyes widened.
Come on.
Nope. Busy, Hiral said. Some mouldy old pickle jars aren't worth the time.
They aren't pickle jars, Gauto said,
clearly insulted by the mundaneness of it.
Weapons, Hiral. Crystal weapons.
That got Hiral's attention, and even he couldn't keep his true feelings off his face.
Crystal? Hiral asked. Like...
He pointed at the nearby pearly white tower, then up its height to the large crystal that sat at its top, 300 feet up. The crystal that grew brighter as Hiral watched, then suddenly went dark, as if all the light inside drained out.
Wait, if the crystal did that, it meant it was...
Hiral blinked and looked at the narrow tower, barely wider than his spread arms from fingertips to fingertips, then at his friend.
That is Lusco's tower, isn't it?
Gauto looked from Hiral to the deep red crystal at the top of the tower and back again.
Speaking of head trauma, did you hit your noggin during the test?
Gauto pointed to another barely visible tower ahead of them, its crystal glittering in the sunlight high above the buildings.
That's Spelina's tower there. Lusco's?
He gestured at the tower near them, then turned and pointed at a third, exactly 3 miles behind them.
And that's Paladis's. You know where we are now? What day it is? Do you remember the 50 chips you owe me?
I don't owe you any money, Hiral snapped, eyes glued to the tower crystal.
So the time is... A few minutes past fifth pulse, Gauto said. Fallen's balls, I'm going to be late, Hiral said. I'll drop by the academy if I have time. Make sure you do, Gauto said as Hiral dashed off. And not just to see the crystal weapons. I want you to double check the numbers on another project for me. I think the island might be slowing down.
Then he was gone, Gauto's words lost to the noise of the market. Hiral shoved his way through the crowd. All thoughts of mysterious underground caverns and crystal weapons fled his mind as he focused entirely on weaving his way through the crowd. Sure, if he had had Meridian Line-induced strength, he could have barreled through without slowing down. It's what most shapers would have done. And left a dozen broken bones, and Fallen knows how many bruises behind. Instead, his lack of a sun-powered body, his sister's ill-thought-out challenges, and his 20 natural dexterity had taught him something, and he weaved through the constantly moving throng of people like an expert dancer. A turn of an ankle there meant the person was about to change direction,
and Hiral twisted around in perfect time with them, sweeping by so only their clothes barely touched. Another quick sidestep brought him between an arguing couple, but he was gone before the surprise even left their mouths, ducking low under an emphatic gesture, then picking up speed as he found some open ground. Three strides brought him to a full sprint, while the people ahead of him shifted forward and back into two solid lines, which could only mean... Hiral vaulted up and over the cart as it was pushed out into the street, his legs just an inch above the carefully piled fruit, then touched down and turned for a quick apology. The small shriek of surprise from ahead was his only warning as he turned his attention around, where a small child, maybe 5 years old, suddenly moved in front of him. Again, while a real shaper probably would have simply gone through the child and then blamed the kid for not moving, Hiral instead kicked off his lead foot into a high cartwheel. His eyes met the child's as he sailed over, their faces close enough, their noses almost touched. Then his feet were on the ground again, and he was running off. This time, he didn't try to turn around to apologize, and his own words were lost to the wind as he ducked behind one of the stalls and ran through the clearer space against the wall. Several annoyed barkers shouted after him, but they paid him little heed other than that. Few people tried to steal, with Shaper Justice being what it was. A left turn down a side alley, another twist around an intimate embrace, then it was clear running. Good thing, too. If he wasn't at the port in the next 15 minutes, Artie might well leave without him. That, or he'd yell, and Fallen knew which was worse. Chapter 6. The City That Chases the Sun.
What took you so long?
Artie yelled at Hiral.
We were just about to leave.
He dramatically pointed at the pier. The empty pier. Hiral raised an eyebrow at the excitable merchant, and Artie squinted his eyes.
Glasses, glasses, glasses,
the man muttered as he rifled through the pockets of his knee-length jacket.
There,
he said, finally pulling the pair of glasses out and putting them on. A second look at the pier, a few blinks, then he turned his attention to a large pile of boxes near the end of the dock.
Why aren't we ready to leave?
He shouted at the three hulking shapers.
You told us to wait for...
The one in the front, Shaper Fual, started.
Told you that ages ago,
Artie shouted.
Get the platform out and load it up.
Sure, sure,
Fual said, strolling out along the pier and then stopping at the end. Large tattoos covered his body from head to toe, though his meridian lines weren't naturally luminescent from long use, and one tattoo in particular, on his upper right chest, began to gently glow as he reached up and touched it. From a distance, it looked like little more than a large square filling with the light flowing out of Fual's fingertips. The platform of movement, a lesser C-rank version of the disc of passage Hiral had on his left calf. Had he been able to shape, he'd have been the one carrying them down to the nomads under the city. While Hiral watched, 1 second stretched into 2, 3, 4, 5. Fual had never been the fastest shaper. C-rank output rate at the highest. More and more light worked its way through the intricate details that made up the tattoo, until finally something snapped into place and the color went from a bright white to a warm glow. Nodding to himself, Fual pulled his hand away from the tattoo, a streamer of liquid light like a plasma flare trailing behind and connecting to the tattoo. He looked over at Artie.
Right here?
Of course, right there,
Artie snapped back.
Same place as always.
Fual nodded again, then jerked his arm out, the tether of light growing taut in an instant and pulling the glowing tattoo off his chest. In less than a heartbeat, the hand-sized block of light grew into a floating platform of heavy stone bricks, 40 feet by 40 feet, perfectly level except for the small pillar in the center he would use to direct its movement.
"Ready to be loaded up?"
Fual said, stepping off the wooden dock and onto the platform.
"I can see that. So what are you all waiting for?"
He gestured at the other two shapers leaning against the pile of boxes. Without a word, the towering man and woman effortlessly began moving crates as big as Hiral, and likely twice as heavy.
"Just about to leave?"
Hiral asked, with an effort to keep the sarcasm out of his voice.
"Just is relative, obviously,"
Artie snapped.
"Are you going to help or stand there?"
"Let me get my stuff from my locker."
"Ah, you're fine the way you are. We're just going down to make an exchange with Carvan for quills. You won't need your weapons."
"I'm supposed to be a guard," Hiral said. "What good is a guard without weapons?" The skin around Artie's eyes tightened, and he stepped in closer to Hiral.
"Didn't go well today, then?"
he asked quietly. Hiral forced the smile back onto his face. "Almost had it this time. Next year for sure," he said, repeating his mantra.
"Do you need the day? Those lugs can manage. Not much use when it comes to thinking, but they can lift a box like nobody's business."
"They can also hear a pin drop from 40 feet away,"
Shaper Geno shouted in her deep voice.
"Should be lifting instead of listening,"
Artie said without turning. "Nah, I'm fine," Hiral said, only stealing a glance at the Shapers. If they hadn't heard about his test, well, they knew the result now. If he took Artie up on the offer, as appealing as it was, that'd just make it look like he was running away. Shapers respected facing things head on. He'd do that here.
"Well, we won't be there long anyway. Should just be a quick down and back. Few hours, tops. Assuming the crates ever get loaded,"
he added, turning back to the working Shapers. For their part, the towering trio ignored the mouthy merchant and his usual behaviour. Really, Artie wasn't a bad guy, and he paid well for people to put up with him. While his class was technically an artist, he'd branched out into the merchant field to acquire some of the highest quality quills in the city from the nomads below. Without those quills, it would be impossible for artists like Hiral's father to do their best work. Or any work at all, really. "Last time we went down, Carvan only had a half order, and not his usual quality," Hiral said. "You think he'll have what we need this time?"
"He'd better,"
Artie said, while glaring at the three Shapers.
"I've got customers practically beating down my door looking for new quills. You know, if we could find a way to use a quill more than once, we wouldn't have this problem."
"Or if we could harvest them anywhere but from the backs of some very particular animals, only found in specific dungeons on the surface," Hiral added. "Hasn't anybody tried breeding them?"
"They die quickly outside of their natural habitat. Something about the dungeons. I can't believe we call them that. They're caves. Is important to their life cycle. Maybe you should bring some of your friends from the academy. See if they can't figure it out."
The nomads wouldn't let us go on a dungeon run with them," Hiral said. "What did they say? Proprietary information?"
"Proprietary price gouging, if you ask me," Artie seethed. "If we don't know where the dungeons are ourselves, we can't send some of our own muscleheads down to clean the place out."
"Muscleheads that can still hear you,"
Shaper Geno called, a massive crate on each shoulder.
"Bah,"
Artie said with a wave, and pointed at the rest of the crates.
"Seriously, Hiral, I'd pay good chips to get a look at one of these dungeons where the quillbacks live. There must be a reason the nomads call them dungeons instead of caves. And what's so special about them that the quillbacks can only live there? The surface is such a mysterious place.
Mysterious and dangerous, Hiral amended, walking over to the edge of the pier with Artie, as his eyes scanned the horizon for the distant, ever-present storm wall. Just over 100 miles away, surrounding the city in a perfect circle, the churning grey clouds poured torrential rain on the ground that slowly scrolled past 9 miles below the city. What do you think it's like down there? I mean, really like?
Our ancestors left for a reason, Hiral, Artie said,
but he also looked down at the distant landscape.
Built an entire floating island that circles the world to follow the sun for a reason. It must have been a good one to go to all that trouble. I'm more than happy to stay up here where it's safe.
And where you can make enough chips to feed your hoarding hobby,
Shaper Geno said as she walked past with two more huge crates.
It's not hoarding, it's collecting. And you wouldn't understand,
Artie said.
They're works of art,
he added, only loud enough for Hiral to hear. Hiral nodded, but wasn't really paying attention to the exchange. The ground below them was so green, with a valley over that way, wide forest blanketing the rest until the terrain changed drastically to towering mountains ahead. The highest peak still didn't reach even close to the main island, but the nomads' trailing islands would flow right between them as the city moved in that direction along the Ensath River. Do the nomads ever talk about the river? Hiral asked Artie. About why the city always follows its path around and around the world?
Some stories that are little more than superstition, if you ask me,
Artie said.
I think the Academy's theory is more likely.
Hiral nodded again. Path of least resistance. It's the only passage through the mountains ahead, and others.
A few more minutes and we'll be ready to go, Shaper Geno said on another pass. Anything else in the warehouse?
No, everything was already out here and waiting to go, Artie said.
Got it. We'll let you know when it's done.
I'm going to go grab the weapons, Hiral said. I know we're just going down to Carven's Island, not the surface or anything, but at least let me look like I'm doing my job.
You're there as much for your eye for quills as anything else, Artie said.
Multitasking, so you keep me around, Hiral said, backing away from the edge of the pier, then spinning on his heel and jogging back to the warehouse. He nodded at a few of the workers inside. They knew him from his years working for Artie and generally kept the gossip to a minimum when he was around, but didn't slow until he got to his locker. A quick wave of his hand past the crystal sensor, and the door popped open to reveal the few belongings he left there, his weapons among them. The sigh escaped his lips before he could stop it, and Hiral shook his head. Last time he'd hung these up, it had been with the hopes he'd never need them again, that he'd pass the test today.
Looks like you're stuck with me a little longer,
he whispered to the sheathed swords before slipping them over his shoulders and securing the belt across his chest. A quick check to make sure nothing rubbed the wrong way, then he stepped back and closed the locker door.
You'll get it next time,
a voice said from where the door had just been, and Hiral nearly jumped out of his skin.
Fallen knickers in a knot, Hiral cursed. You scared me, Nunnally.
Sorry,
the older woman said quietly.
I wanted to catch you before you went down with Artie. You can do it. I know you can.
Thanks, Nunnally, Hiral said, his breathing back under control after the startle.
Yeah, I've got it next year for sure. Just you watch.
Nunnally nodded but didn't say anything else, and Hiral gave her a small wave before he jogged back out of the building. Sure, he talked a good game, but what was he going to do differently next time? Maybe it was time to pay the Academy another visit. He'd checked before about anybody with his condition, but maybe he'd missed it. Or maybe he could find something else to help him along. That was how he'd figured out that training without using the meridian lines improved experience and attribute gains.
We're ready to go, Hiral. Get over here!
Artie called from where he stood beside Shaper Fual on the platform.
Sorry, coming!
Hiral called back, putting the academy out of his mind until he got back. Chapter 7 Nomads. The platform pulled away from the pier without even a shudder, and then arched out slightly from the island to avoid clipping any of the other piers. Hiral, meanwhile, stepped up to the edge of the platform so the crates didn't obscure his view, and simply enjoyed his favourite part of going down to the nomads. Up in the city of Fallen Reach itself, the scale of the island floating in the sky was completely lost, and Hiral's eyes traced down along the rock underneath. Like something had reached into the ground and scooped an upside-down mountain out, then tossed it into the air, the image of the floating island still defied reason, no matter how many times he'd seen it. Even though the city occupied about half of the island's 30-mile surface diameter, the mile-deep bottom completely filled Hiral's sight as the platform gently descended. Dropping below the outer edge, his eyes naturally turned to the spiraling mist that stretched from the island all the way to the river 9 miles below. Hundreds and hundreds of feet across, the source of all water on the island, it looked like a thick wall of almost impenetrable fog, even from 15 miles away. Then, there, trailing near the backmost point of the island, the numerous smaller nomad islands followed like some kind of comet's tail, though the highest of their islands was only about 3/4 of the way up. That highest island, where the elders of the nomads resided, was also the only nomad island directly under Fallen Reach. Dozens of other islands of varying smaller sizes followed behind, connected by huge routes that lashed them to the largest island in the front of the pack.
"Looks like they lost one of the smaller islands from the back," Artie said, coming up to stand beside Hiral.
Hiral did some quick math in his head, then nodded. "It's been almost a full rotation since they lost the last one. Good thing we're coming up on the Needle Mountains soon. They should be able to find another one there." Artie's mouth made a thin line in response. "You don't agree?" Hiral asked.
"Needle Mountains live up to their name," Artie said, pointing towards the mountain range as the platform continued its descent. "Narrow and sharp, more like giant stone tree trunks than actual mountains, it's harder for them to find something large enough to make into an island. Has to have the right composition to get caught up in Fallen Reach's magic too, even if they manage to connect it to the others."
"Huh, hadn't thought of that," Hiral said. "You know, now that you mention it, I don't think I've ever been down to the nomads with you while we're passing over the needles. Why's that?"
"No quills while we're in the needles," Artie said. "If there are even any dungeons down there, the nomads don't go. Too hard to get back up to their own islands since they can't reliably climb the needles."
Hiral looked from Artie back to the needles. Fallen Reach moved at a constant, never-changing 3 miles per hour, and the edge of the needles was just visible outside the storm wall, which meant about 100 miles away. 3 cycles, and they'd be there. "So you're saying that if Carven doesn't have any quills for us, we won't have a chance to get more before we come out the other side of the mountains?"
"Longer than that," Artie said. "The Sea of White is on the other side. It'll be at least 30 cycles until the next dungeon. And after the last short shipment, well, we're running out of stock as it is."
"So why do we load so much onto the platform?" Shaper Geno asked.
"Carven is good for it," Artie said, shivering and rubbing his arms. "We've been trading for years, and they rely on what we're bringing down just as much as we rely on the quills they provide. And why in the Fallen's names is it so cold?"
"Oh, sorry," Shaper Fual said, running his hand across one of the crystals on the pillar in the center of the platform.
There. I turned up the protection magic to keep the cold out a bit more.
Hiral looked, only slightly enviously, at the control pillar. The disc on his left calf would take care of environmental conditions automatically, as well as move much faster than the platform. If only he could shape it. On the whole island, there were only a dozen people or so who had the disc and could activate it. Being in that crowd, well, that'd show everybody. Prove them all wrong. Though technically, they weren't wrong. Yet.
Looks like Carvan is already waiting for us, Artie said, gesturing with his chin to the third island,
his hands still rubbing up and down his arms, despite the cold being held back.
Watch out for the kites on our right, Fual.
See them,
Shaper Fual said, shifting the direction of the platform to avoid the kites transporting nomads between the islands.
Why don't they just walk like normal people?
Hiral raised his eyebrow at the Shaper.
We're not walking, and it would take forever to follow the routes from one island to another. Those kites are dangerous, Shaper Fual went on. How do they even control where they're going without magic?
You complain about the same thing every time,
Shaper Geno piped up.
Why don't you just ask one of them this time?
Me? An islander? Talk to one of those filthy buggers? No, thank you. I might catch something.
Shaper Fuel's chin rose higher with each word.
No offence, Artie.
It's fine, Artie said. Thinking like that is why I can trade with the nomads without much competition. Keep the bugger talk to yourself while we're down there. The hives they farm are important to them.
I know, Shaper Fual said. But seriously, how can they spend so much time around bugs, almost as big as Hiral? And eating them? Just yuck.
They're just livestock like our cattle,
Artie said without turning, his hand going up into the air to wave at somebody on the nearby island.
Now really, enough. Time to get down to business.
I don't see a lot of crates there waiting for us, Hiral said, looking from Carvan waving back to the cleared-off area for the platform.
Depending on the wind, they get spray from the mist, Artie said. Probably have the crates inside to keep the goods dry. Probably.
Probably, Hiral agreed, but he scrolled his gaze along the edge of the island. There seemed to be a bit of commotion further down. Half a dozen people with... Wait, weren't those the suits they used to go down to the surface? If what he knew about dungeon runs was true, they'd barely have time to get down and back before the last island reached the needles.
Carvan, my friend,
Artie shouted as the platform gently settled down on the island.
Have you been? Artie, it's good to see you,
Carvan replied. But the hand he held up in greeting was the only open part about his body language. His other hand was held in a fist, and there was an unusual tightness to his shoulders. The man didn't have good news. And from the way Artie's hand dropped to his side, he saw it too.
Things haven't improved, Artie asked.
Carvan shook his head, his other hand balling into a fist at his side as well.
I'm afraid not. We're still waiting for the harvesting party to return.
To return? Artie asked. Shouldn't they have been back a cycle ago?
Two, Carvan said.
Any idea what happened?
Artie asked, genuine concern in his voice as he stepped off the platform and walked up to Carvan. Hiral quickly joined him, though the three Shapers stayed firmly in place on the platform.
None. It should have been an easy trip,
Carvan said, his voice cracking with the words.
Your niece is part of the party, isn't she?
Artie reached out to put a hand on the other man's shoulder.
One of them,
Carvan said, his head turning briefly to look at the group of people preparing the kite-like suits further down the edge of the island.
The other is planning something stupid.
But just because they aren't back yet, that could mean a few things, right? Maybe they just had to make for another jump point.
That's one of the possibilities, Carven said. The one we're hoping for. The other possibility is that they're...
Where's the dungeon they went to? Hiral asked as the man trailed off, unable to finish his sentence.
Almost directly below us, Carven said.
And it was a testament to just how worried he was that he answered Hiral's question so quickly. So there's still time for them to get back to the islands before we've passed, Hiral said. There's still hope.
Thank you, Carven said with a grateful nod. Now, if I could just convince Cena of that, fool girl is insisting to go looking for her sister. I've tried to stop her and the others, but they'll be ready to go within the hour.
If they go, Artie started, they risk not making it back in time.
I know. It's cutting it too close, and that's if things go perfectly.
The party that went to the dungeon, what rank were they?
Artie asked.
All high E rank, close to breaking through to D.
Why didn't you send anybody of a higher rank? Hiral asked. Somebody with more experience.
It's only an E rank area. This is how we do things, Carven answered.
Then his eyes widened, like he realized he shouldn't have spoken so frankly.
What classes did they have?
Artie pressed on. Carven looked off to the side, then back to Artie.
You know I can't talk about that. I've already said more than I should in my worry. Please forget most of what you've heard.
Hiral glanced at Artie, then back at Carven. In those few sentences, they'd learned more about these so-called dungeons than the nomads had revealed in years.
Artie, I know this is a lot to ask, Carven said,
but his eyes went to the platform behind the merchant.
I can't stop Cena and the others from going down, so I was hoping you could perhaps take them on your...
But Artie was already shaking his head.
Afraid not. The platforms of movement don't have the range to make the trip. It can go maybe 4 miles before it needs to stop. We'd get halfway to the ground, then fall the rest of the way. It wouldn't help anybody. If we had a disc of passage, maybe we could talk about it.
Artie then coughed, apparently remembering what Hiral had tattooed on his leg.
I see, Carven said,
not even looking in Hiral's direction. With the lairs he wore down to see the nomads every time, they didn't even know he was trying to be a shaper. They thought he was an artist like Artie, which was fine by Hiral. All makers, or islanders as the nomads called them, had the meridian lines, so it wasn't possible to tell artists apart from shapers by their faces alone.
So, there's nothing you can do to help?
Carven asked, a hint of desperation clear in his voice. The look on his face told it all. He was terrified of not losing just one niece, but two. Artie shook his head again.
I wish I could,
the merchant said, not even mentioning the quills that were supposed to be part of the deal.
I see, Carven said, slightly deflating. Thank you for at least entertaining my offer.
Of course.
Carven looked at the girl who had to be his niece further along the edge, then back towards the house near the small warehouse.
About the other reason I asked you to come today,
he said with a sigh of resignation, his face lowered.
Did you bring your tools?
Tools? What tools would Artie need? He was an artist.
Why don't we talk about it in your home?
Artie said, throwing quick glances from Hiral to the shapers on the platform.
Talk about the quills you were referring to,
he said again, throwing a painfully obvious wink in Carven's direction. Carven's eyebrows bunched up, and his mouth made a little O shape as he looked at Hiral.
Right, the quills, he said. I'll just be inside with Evanin, so she can talk to you about the quills, he finished,
giving his own version of the painfully obvious wink. Artie winced and nodded.
Right, right. I'll be along in a few minutes.
He watched as Carvin retreated back to his home.
Let's you and me go for a walk,
Artie said, putting his arm over Hiral's shoulder and leading him in the direction of the party getting ready to go to the surface.
What was that all about? Hiral asked.
Well,
he started, but then looked back at the shapers again.
Should be far enough, even with their stupid hearing,
he muttered. Far enough for what? What do you need your tools for? You can't tattoo nomads.
Tattoo? No, more of a glyph. Something much simpler than a tattoo,
Artie said sheepishly.
A glyph? Hiral asked. Wait, Evanin is Carvin's wife. You're not doing a glyph of fertility, are you? Those are illegal.
Shh,
Artie said, throwing more looks back at the shapers, though none of them seemed to have heard Hiral.
They're illegal in Fallen Reach because of the side effects they have on makers, on our race. Nomads are a different race. Growers, they call themselves. The glyph doesn't have the same risks to them. It's safe.
You're sure?
How? Hiral asked, but the look on Artie's face told it all. Oh, this isn't your first time.
It's how I got the trade contracts in the first place,
Artie admitted.
Look, you've got to keep this to yourself. Even if it's safe for growers, the council in Fallen Reach won't think the same. I'd lose more than my merchant's license, if you catch my drift. Might get to see the surface after all, while falling the 9 miles to get there.
Hiral rubbed the bridge of his nose, but nodded. Artie wasn't exaggerating. Council law wasn't often invoked, mainly because of how serious they took it. I won't rat you out, but I'm not going to go in with you and watch you do it.
Good, because you're not invited. Besides, I've got something better for you to do,
Artie said, a small wave of relief washing over him.
Oh, am I going to like it?
He suspected he knew the answer.
Depends on how much you like talking to girls your own age, Artie said. Go talk to that Cena girl. See if you can't find out a bit more about the dungeons. We may not be back here for a year, but the more we know...
Fine, Hiral said. If he was honest with himself, he was pretty curious about the dungeons.
Good. I'll come find you when I'm done. Try to stay out of trouble.
Out of the pair of us, I'm not the one who gets into trouble,
Hiral said, before spinning on his heel and starting over towards the small group getting their equipment ready to jump off the island. Chapter 8. The Fall. Hiral approached the small group working on checking bags, some of the kites they used to go between islands, and even a few weapons. It consisted of 4 young men and a young woman who had to be Cena, unless the child playing around the group, she couldn't have been more than 5, was actually the secret leader of the party.
Hi, Hiral said as he walked up to them, his hand up. Anything I can do to help?
A few turned their heads in his direction, took in his islander clothes, and then went back to what they were doing.
Your face is funny looking,
a small voice said from beside him, and Hiral looked down to find the child standing in front of him, a kite almost as big as she was in her hand.
I get that a lot, Hiral said.
He crouched down in front of the girl, then scrunched up his nose, squeezed his eyes shut, and stuck out his tongue.
Not that kind of funny-looking silly,
she said. When Hiral opened his eyes again to look at her, she reached out and poked him in the cheek, right where his meridian line was.
Did somebody draw on you?
Kind of, Hiral said. Everybody has these where I'm from. Well, everybody older than 10 or 12.
Ooh,
she said, tilting her head up to look at Fallen Reach high above them, where the sun just glinted over the edge like a horizon.
You're from up there?
I sure am.
Is it hot? So close to the sun?
We're not actually that much closer.
Yeah, you are,
she said, pointing up.
Way closer.
Ah, okay. Good point, he said, instead of arguing about it. But no, it's not really hotter. It's actually cooler the higher up you go. But the magic of the island keeps it comfortable. Same as here. He then took a good look at the girls' clothes and the clothes of the group preparing to go down. They were just as layered up as Hiral was. And they weren't the only ones. Everybody he saw was dressed for cool weather. There wasn't any magic here to keep the temperature constant. How had he never noticed before? Ah, because he was too caught up in himself to think about it, most likely.
We don't use magic for that, silly,
the girl said, confirming what Hiral was just figuring out.
It's for growing stuff,
she added proudly, pointing to a green fence that started about 100 feet away, then continued off into the distance. Considering how high up they were, a wall around the edge made sense, except in areas like the port.
Come on, Favela, don't bother him,
the woman around Hiral's age said, coming over and putting her hands on the young girl's shoulders. She's not bothering me, Hiral said. She's actually teaching me quite a lot. You must be Sina, right? Ah, sorry, I'm Hiral. The woman's eyes narrowed at him, but she gave a single nod.
Go play, Favela, but stay away from the edge, or I'll take your kite away from you. No, it's mine,
Favela said, clutching the kite closer to her chest.
You said it was.
And it will be, as long as you stay away from the edge, the woman replied, staring at Favela until the younger girl nodded. Good. Now off you go. She really wasn't bothering me, Hiral said.
I know. Now, how do you know my name?
So you are Sina, then? Hiral asked, then waited until the woman nodded. I'm here with Artie to trade with Carvin. He said something happened to your sister. I'm sorry.
Nothing happened to her. She just decided to stop and look at something shiny. Gets distracted easily,
Sina said defensively. You're probably right, Hiral said. But if that was all you were worried about, would you really be getting ready to go down to the surface yourself? Sina glared at him for a moment while chewing on her bottom lip.
She also trips and falls a lot, she finally said. I'm just going to help.
But from what I understand, it's pretty risky. You could miss making it back up.
We'll make it. We've done it before in less time, she said, looking back at the four men, quickly getting their equipment in order.
Are the dungeons really that dangerous? Hiral asked, his eyes on a pair of spears. I thought I heard something about you not killing the quillbacks to get their quills.
Quillbacks aren't the only thing down there,
Sina said, part of the worry over her sister seeping out into her words. But she quickly turned her head towards the edge.
Hey, Favela, what did I say about getting too close to the edge? But the wind is better here for the kite,
Favela whined, the kite a few feet above her and climbing.
You'll lose it to that wind, Sina said. No, I won't. I have a good grip. See?
Favela showed the thick kite string looped over and over around her wrist and hand.
Doesn't matter. It's not safe over there. Come back here before you...
Sina started, but cut off as a gust of wind whooshed by her, like it had a mind of its own, and yanked the kite high into the air with a sound like a whip. And then everything happened all at once.
Favela!
Sina screamed. Instincts Hiral didn't know he had kicked in, and he dashed forward. Even with 20 dexterity, though, he wasn't fast enough, and the good grip Favela had on her kite hauled the girl right up into the air with it as it went. Up and out over the edge. Favela's eyes opened wide in shock as her feet sailed away from solid ground, the kite still pulling her up. Could he make it? Grab her before she dropped? The gust of wind faded, and then Favela was gone.
No, 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 no!
Hiral changed the angle of his dash, just slightly, grabbed one of the kites used to go between islands, then sprinted hard for the edge. A quick glance told him there were straps that looked like they were meant to go around his wrists, while he held onto the kite with both hands. He didn't have time for those. Or for both hands. With one hand wrapped as tight around the main shaft of the large kite as 18 strength would allow, Hiral ignored his mind, telling him this was a stupid idea, and leapt off the edge of the island. Already hundreds of feet below him, Favela's face was a mask of shock and fear as she looked back up at the sky, arms and legs flailing, the ground miles below. Miles that would vanish all too quickly, and that was assuming Hiral wanted to reach the surface, which he certainly did not. Not like this.
"I'm coming!"
he shouted, all his focus on the girl below him. He tucked the kite against his side like a shield as he dove down, cutting the air like a knife. The wind whistled in his ears, slashed at his eyes as tears flew away, and tried to rip the kite from his hand. Body rigid, Hiral hurtled downward, each small shift of his body or gust of wind threatening to take him off course. The girl screamed, her voice reaching Hiral's ears in strange, alternating waves as he raced down toward her, the hood over his head snapping back and his hair whipping in the wind. And somehow, her kite was nowhere to be seen. Of course she let go of it now. Squeezing his right hand as tight as he could around his kite's shaft, Hiral extended his left hand out toward Favela, though she was still more than 100 feet away. The small shift changed the angle of the kite, and suddenly Hiral was barreling off to the side, whipping out wide from where he needed to be to catch her. His fall devoured distance like a starving man, islands coming into view in his peripheral vision, and then gone again, bare seconds later. He'd closed half the distance to Favela, but was now 50 feet out too wide. Her arms and legs still flailed as she fell, increasing her wind resistance, and if Hiral didn't do something now, he'd shoot past her. Muscles in his abdomen tensing, Hiral twisted ever so slightly, the kite at his side cutting the air and dragging him back across to where he needed to be so hard he almost got whiplash. But at least he'd... No, his momentum took him too far in the wrong direction. He'd overshot where he needed to be and cut the vertical distance between them in half. He needed to change the angle again, but that would only do the same thing he'd just done, whipping him past. He couldn't get back directly above her. He just didn't have the practice or control, so he'd need to snag her on the way by.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Everfail.
A child's voice seemed to echo on the wind.
What was he thinking? He couldn't do this. He couldn't even pass a children's test. What had made him jump off the Fallen's arse end of an island in the first place? Funny face.
Favela's voice somehow broke through the wind, whipping past his ears, and Hiral forced himself to look at her. At her wide eyes and face full of fear. That was why he had jumped without thinking. She simply didn't deserve to die like this.
I'm coming, Favela!
Hiral shouted, though whether she could hear him or not was impossible to tell. So he stretched his hand in her direction, fingers wide like he was reaching for her, and her hand reached toward him. Maybe he couldn't do this, just like he couldn't pass the test to be a shaper. But that had never stopped him from trying before, and it wasn't going to stop him now. Hiral twisted the kite in his hand, the drag in the air practically flipping him over as it shot him towards Favela. Spinning, once, twice, round and round, Hiral's eyes never left that small hand reaching for him. At 15 feet away, the wind gusted and tried to yank him off course. He pulled the kite closer, and snapped back toward Favela. At 10 feet, he was upside down, hands stretched out and eyes watering from forcing them to stay open. At 5 feet, Favela's lips moved to form.
Funny face.
Reach!
He pleaded with his hand, as the wind swirled around them like a living thing, threatening to pull them apart. His fingers brushed against something, skin, cold from the wind, but then slipped past.
No, he'd missed, he...
Something dragged on his sleeve. Favela's small hand had somehow found a grip, and Hiral twisted his body around under hers, using the wide side of the kite to slow his descent so that she practically fell into his chest.
I've got you, he said, snaking his left hand around her wrist and pulling her into him. Put your arms around my neck. Go on, hurry, I've got you, he coaxed, until she let go of his hand and wrapped her small arms around him.
More islands whizzed past the corners of his eyes. How far had they fallen? How many islands were left?
It didn't matter. He was going to make this happen. This is going to be bumpy, he said. But no matter what, do not let go. Okay? Can you do that?
Favela's small head nodded against his neck, and Hiral made sure he had as good a grip on her with his left hand as he could. With her
small... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.